Peace be with you. Friends, it's a joy to welcome you to worship on this holy feast of the Epiphany of our Lord. Epiphany marks the end of the Christmas season, but is itself a cause for great celebration and wonderment. All that you need to participate fully in this service is an open heart and spirit, and if you'd like to follow our reading, a Bible, or a search engine, to look up Matthew chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. And here I'm using the New Revised Standard Version, or NRSV, Bible. Let's hear these words from the Gospel of the Lord together now. In the time of King Herod, after Jesus was born in Bethlehem of Judea, wise men from the east came to Jerusalem, asking, "Where is the child who has been born King of the Jews? For we observed his star at its rising and have come to pay him homage." When King Herod heard this, he was frightened, and all Jerusalem with him. And calling together all the chief priests and scribes of the people, he inquired of them where the Messiah was to be born. They told him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for so it has been written by the prophet, 'And you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means the least among the rulers of Judah. For from you shall come a ruler who is to shepherd my people Israel.'" Then Herod secretly called for the wise men and learned from them the exact time that the star had appeared. Then he sent them to Bethlehem, saying, "Go and search diligently for the child, and when you have found him, bring me word so that I may also go and pay him homage." When they had heard the king, they set out, and there ahead of them went the star that they had seen at its rising, until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw that the star had stopped, they were overwhelmed with joy. On entering the house, they saw the child with Mary, his mother, and they knelt down and paid him homage. Then, opening their treasure chests, they offered him gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to return to Herod, they left for their own country by another road. This is the Gospel of Christ. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Well, my friends, Epiphany marks the visit of the Magi to the Holy Family. It is a wonderful day for celebration, and I'm so glad you could all join today to mark this holy feast together as a community in this online space. What do we know about the Magi? Our tradition holds that they were kings from the East. We three kings of Orient are. King is one way that you could translate the word magis, or the plural magi. But the gospel in our translation is a little more precise when it calls these magi not kings, but wise men. One school of thought is that these men belong to the priesthood of an ancient Persian religion called Zoroastrianism. Incidentally, a religion still practiced by as many as 2 million people worldwide. Freddie Mercury was a Zoroastrian. As Zoroastrians, these magi paid particular attention to the movements of the stars. They based much of their religion on astrology, not astronomy, astrology, which today ranks somewhere near palm reading or gazing into crystal balls, but at the time was considered a high science. So these wise men from the East were not so much foreign kings come to pay homage to a new monarch in a distant land. Rather, they were scientists, clergy of a foreign religion. And God used their faith and their learning to bring them to Christ. That's quite something. But more confounding, more ironic even, is the fact that God used these scientists and practitioners of a foreign religion to reveal to mighty King Herod and the chief priests and scribes, the religious hierarchy of Israel, that the Messiah was born. Think of just how far God reaches to ensure that all people receive the good news of Christ's birth. You've seen a creche, I'm sure, many times, a nativity scene. Jesus in the manger, Mary, Joseph, the animals, the shepherds, and the kings bearing gifts. Hold that scene in your mind for a moment. What do you see there? From the lowliest shepherds to the loftiest magi, from simpletons to sages, all the way up the social pecking order, the intellectual pecking order, every human category. The scene at the creche shows us that God is willing to do whatever it takes to reach out to all people. God announces the birth of the Messiah in several ways. And from the manger in which Christ lies wrapped in swaddling clothes, God's kingdom grows bigger and bigger and bigger. Now, it's true that in biblical scholarship, the visit of the Magi is generally considered to be somewhat removed from the Christmas event itself. You'll notice in the Gospel that it says that the Magi enter the house where Mary is with the child Jesus, not into the stable or the barn. But we treat it as being of a piece. This is all part of Christ's incarnation, part of God's self-revelation to the world. Now, it presents a challenge for us, I think. If these magi were scientists, clergy of another religion than Christ's own, clergy of a religion that didn't know the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, then how is it that they were called to look upon the face of the newborn Messiah and pay him homage? Surely God could have called one of the chief priests or scribes, a member of the religious hierarchy of his chosen Israel. It's a little as if Christ came again and was greeted not by the Archbishop of Canterbury or the Pope or the Patriarch of the East, but rather by a group of taxi drivers, and later by Buddhist monks bearing gifts. It just doesn't make sense in our categories, in our reckoning. And because it doesn't make sense, we are challenged to consider just how far God is willing to go to bring the good news of Jesus Christ to the world. God's incredible grace is more than a little surprising. In my life, I've been surprised by the unusual ways in which God reveals himself to the world and to people in their life's journeys. Thinking of the Magi, I can see that right from the beginning, God was interested in announcing his presence not just to those who were on the inside, but perhaps even more so to those who were on the outside. And this challenges me to think what implications this has on my own understanding of what it means to experience Christ's love, what it means to call him Lord of all creation, what it means to have faith in him, what it means to be the church, what capacity God has to surprise me, to surprise us. Because if God no longer has the capacity to surprise you, you're going to have to decide if you're worshiping God at all in the first place anymore. You see, the Magi didn't come to see Jesus because they'd heard a really great preacher. They didn't come because they'd participated in a beautiful, godly liturgy, received a sacrament, were warmly welcomed when they visited a church or asked to join a committee or two. They came to see Jesus after watching the night skies. What kind of sense does that make? If a new rector were interviewing for a position in a new parish, and the committee asked him, "What are your plans to grow our parish?" and he said, "Stargazing," I'm not sure the interview would last much longer than that. What kind of sense does this make? But you see, actually asking that question is really the thing. The thing is, we can't always make sense of the ways of God. We can't always make sense of the way that God works in the world, or how and when and where God chooses to reveal himself in the lives of human beings and communities. What we can do is recognize it when it happens, nurture it, give it growth, get out of the way, and give thanks. Now, the word epiphany literally means coming to light or shining forth. So here are a couple of questions. Where is the light of Christ shining in you? Where is the light of Christ shining in your life? Where is the light of Christ shining in this church, in the wider community, in the world? These are the questions that we need to be asking. This feast, this holy day, this celebration reminds us that we can't always make sense of when or where or how God chooses to act in the world. We certainly can't always predict it. But when we see it, we can know it for what it is. As much as any feast of the church, I love the Epiphany. And I hope that in 2022, we'll be able to gather here at St. John's, as we have for the past number of years, to have a great party. Wine, cheese, a good time of fellowship. I love the Epiphany because there is something counterintuitive about it, right at its very core. Maybe even something countercultural about it. Counterintuitive, I say, because there's a great reason to have a party at Epiphany. In this coldest and darkest season of the year, we Christians gather to celebrate light and illumination. Now, that's counterintuitive, because when should we celebrate light? Well, perhaps like many cultures have done throughout recorded history, and many still do, at the summer solstice, when the day is the longest. But Christians have a tendency to do things a bit differently. We celebrate light and illumination when all around us, at least in this hemisphere, is cold and dark. And in that is represented so much of the Christian hope. that the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. In this celebration is represented something of the topsy-turvy world of the kingdom of God, where true strength comes in vulnerability. True leadership comes through service. True lordship comes not with a crown of gold, but with a crown of thorns. In this Epiphany celebration is represented so much of the Christian vocation to bring light to dark places, to offer our best gifts to the Lord, to bring hope and joy and laughter and good cheer to the hurting places, to bear the light of Christ with us wherever we go. The celebration is countercultural because while the rest of the world is taking down the tinsel and putting the tree out at the curb, we Christians are busy inviting Christ to come into our homes and stay. Epiphany is a season of illumination, where we announce that the Christ light radiates throughout all of creation. It shines in you, and it shines in me. It shines in this parish, but just as importantly, it shines everywhere else that is not this parish. It shines throughout the whole world. Those foreign clergy, those astrologers, those magi, followed the star in the sky to the point where it stopped, shining its light on the newborn king. But when we flip the pages of our Bibles ahead, just three chapters, we find that same king, now grown into a man, climbing a mountain with many gathered around him. And on that mountain, he does not say, "Blessed am I." Instead, he says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, the pure in heart, those who mourn. Blessed are the peacemakers." And then in those most empowering words, those most illuminating words, he says, "You are the light of the world. You are the ones through whom the world can encounter me, the living God." What a wondrous thought that the star of Bethlehem, as bright as it was, bright enough to lead magi to the manger, pales by comparison to the light of Christ that exists in you and me and the whole world. You are the light of the world. So what will we do with that light? Will we hide it or let it shine before others? Because if we are willing to be that light, if we are willing to invite that light in and ask him to stay, then we might just be the way that others find that they too are bearers of the Christ light. We might be the revelation of God to someone else. We might just be the epiphany that so many in the world are looking for. And by the grace of God, with the empowering of the Holy Spirit, may it be so. Amen. Now, my friends, I invite you to join with Elizabeth Barlow, our organist and director of music, as we sing the hymn, "As with Gladness, Men of Old." Let us worship the Savior with joy and make our prayer to our Heavenly Father, saying, Lord of glory, hear our prayer. The Magi came from the east to worship your Son. Father, grant to Christians everywhere the spirit of adoration. And let us say together, Lord of glory, hear our prayer. The infant Christ received gifts of gold, incense, and myrrh. Father, accept the offering of our hearts and minds. Lord of glory, hear our prayer. The kingdoms of this world have become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ. Father, grant an abundance of peace to your world. Lord of glory, hear our prayer. The Holy Family lived in exile and in the shadow of death. Father, look in mercy on all who are poor and powerless, and all who suffer. Lord of glory, hear our prayer. Your Son shared the life of his home and family at Nazareth. Father, protect in your love our neighbors, our families, and this community of which we are a part. Lord of glory, hear our prayer. Father, we rejoice in our fellowship with the shepherds, the angels, the Magi, the Virgin Mary, Saint Joseph, and all the faithful departed. In your unfailing love for us and for all people, hear and answer our prayers through your Son, our Savior. Lord of glory, hear our prayer. Eternal God, who by a star led wise men to the worship of your Son, guide by your light the nations of the earth, that the whole world may know your glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And now with confidence and trust, let us pray as our Savior Christ has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now, may the God of infinite goodness scatter the darkness of sin and brighten your hearts with holiness. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you this day and remain with you always. Amen.